All right, so welcome back everybody for this afternoon session of the Chennai Symposium. And there's a slight change in the schedule. So we'll be going ahead with the second talk of the session first. So the first speaker will be then Shilpa Kasta from MPI, I guess Potsdam. And she'll be talking about tests of general relativity with the gravitational wave observations. So Shilpa, you will have 25 minutes for your talk. I'll give you an indication at 20, and the remaining 5 minutes will be the question and answer session.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Rajiv.
Over to you.
So there's a slight change. So I'm currently postdoc at Albert Einstein Institute, Hanover, not Potsdam. So today I'll be discussing about tests of general relativity with the gravitational wave observations. Before I start, since due to the time difference, I couldn't attend the first half or the first session where Arun talked about test of GR. So please bear with me if there are some repetition in my talk. I will mostly focus on black hole spectroscopy or testing GR with the ring down part of the waveform. I will also touch upon two more tests that I have been involved in, but will not go through them in details. So this is just a introductory slide about what are gravitational waves, how they propagate, how they get generated, and their polarization contents. And I'm sure all of you are aware of these basics, so I will also not go into the details about these things. So let's move on. So till date, from the three observing runs of the LIGO-Virgo detectors, there have been detection of about 94 compact binary mergers. And here I have shown all the detections from first, second, and first half of the third observing run as a function of their masses. So there were detection of two binary neutron star as well as two black hole neutron star events as well. And as you can see that the most massive detection till date is GW190521. And the remnant mass is about, it lies between 150 to 160 solar mass. And I will be talking more about this event. So move on from the slide. So I'm currently on my fourth slide. I have put up this slide just to show that where exactly the gravitational wave events lie in a plane defined by the field strength, which is roughly goes as M over L, where M is the mass of the system and L is the length or the size of the system. And on the y-axis, it is the curvature, which is roughly goes as square root of m over L cube. And the first two gravitational wave events, 15-12-26 and 15-09-14, they lie on the top right corner. So as you can see, that this is the region where the field strength is the maximum and the curvature is also very strong. So gravitational wave events give a wide opportunity to test GR in the extreme field and extreme curvature limit. Yeah, before going into the details of the various tests, I will briefly mention about gravitational waveform modeling. So here in this plot, by the way, can you see my cursor?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, okay, thank you. So here in this figure, I have just drawn a waveform as a function of time. And the initial part where the two objects are far apart, that part is known as in spiral and is modeled within post-Newtonian theory, which is an analytical formalism. Then the next part, that is when the two objects merge, that part is known as merger, which is modeled with numerical relativity techniques. And the last, where the merged remnant black hole slowly settles down to a stable one, is widely known as ring down, and that part is modeled within black hole perturbation theory. Now, various tests of GR with gravitational waveform developed till date, they are testing these different phases or these different parts of the waveform. So now let's take a look at what are the kind of tests are currently being done. So broadly, the tests could be divided into two categories. The first one is a model-dependent test, where the gravitational wave data is compared against a specific waveform model defined within a particular theory. In this category, there are various tests, which I will not talk about. I will talk about one of them, which is the test formulated with the ring down part of the waveform. And this work was done in collaboration with Colin, Miriam, Jahed, Julian, Badri, and Alex Nelson and Alex Nins. All of them, some of them are still in AI. Some of them have moved to other institutes. I will come to it in a few moments. So now let's take a look at what are model independent tests. So here, given a gravitational wave data, we compare it with a generic waveform model defined by some free parameters. And given the data, one can put bound on those free parameters. So in this category, there lies parameterized post-Einstein formalism, parameterized test of post-Newtonian theory, and a parameterized test of post-Newtonian multipolar structure. So all these three tests have been developed with the in-spiral part of the waveform. Now, in one of these, I have been involved in developing with Anuradha, Arun, Satya, and Chris. So in this parameterized test of post-Newtonian multipolar structure, what we did is we tried to keep track of the contribution from different multipole moments. And given the gravitational wave data, we asked the question how well we can put bounds on those multipole moments of the compact binary merger. There is one more test, which is in spiral merger ring down consistency test in time domain. The basic idea was first formulated in by one of the Indian gravitational wave group that is in ICTS. So they developed it first in frequency domain, but recently we developed it in time domain. From the name, you can understand that this is basically a consistency test between the in-spiral and the merger ring down phase of the waveform. So what we do is we compute the posterior distribution on the initial parameters. And separately and independently, we also get the parameter values from the post-merger part of the waveform and then ask the question that whether they are consistent with each other or not. And the same question can also be posed as a test of Hawking's area theorem, where we can compute the area of the two initial black holes from the in-spiral parameters, and then we can compute the final area of the remnant black hole from the final parameter estimation. And then we can ask the question that with what confidence level Hawking's area theorem is valid given the gravitational wave data. This work is also done in collaboration with my collaborators at AEI Hannover. Yeah, so let's now move over to the ring down test. Before going into the details, I will briefly talk about the event on which we have performed our test, that is JW190521. So on the left plot, I have just shown the Q transform in the three different detectors. So in LIGO Hanford and LIGO Livingston, you can see a bright yellow blob around the frequency range starting from 50 to 100 Hertz. But the power in Virgo is quite less, but still there is something around the same frequency range. And the right side, I have kept this plot just to show that how massive is this system compared to one of my favorites, that is JW150914, or even you can compare with 170608 or 190814. Now the total SNR of this event in the three detectors were around 14. And this event was mainly merger and ring down dominated event. So the SNR, that is the signal to noise ratio in the merger and the ring down part were roughly about 13. So you can understand that this event gives a wide opportunity to do a proper ring down analysis. Yeah. So here I have shown the mass distribution for this particular event. So on the left plot, this is the probability distribution on the component masses reported by the LIGO-Virgo collaboration. But the right side plot was a consequent study by two groups about the mass distribution or the posterior on the component masses. The red curve was done by Alex Nitz and Colin Capano from AI Hanover. What they found is they found a region where the mass ratio is quite high. So the data they found that the data supports a high mass ratio region, which is the mass ratio is about 10. But then later by another group, the same analysis was performed, but with more updated waveform version. And they did not find significant support for mass ratio 10, but still they found a higher mass ratio region compared to what reported by the LIGO-Virgo collaboration. Now, this high mass ratio region actually indicates that there might exist some higher modes in the ring down part of the waveform. Yeah, so now let's look into the ring down part of the waveform. Here in the equation, I have schematically shown the structure of the ring down waveform model, which is written simply in terms of damped sinusoids, where S is capital S is the spheroidal harmonics. Then comes the amplitude of the modes, A subscript LMN. Now, every values of L, M, and N denotes every different quasi-normal modes. And the capital omega element is the complex frequency, which consists of the mode frequency F element and the damping time tau element. Now, in a ring down analysis, what we do is we independently vary A element, phi element, final mass of the remnant black hole, and final spin of the remnant black hole. And Noether theorem states that the frequency and the damping time can be written only in terms of the final mass and the final spin of the black hole, which can be computed using Tucholsky equation. So if we find the posterior distribution on the final mass and final spin, that can be translated to the distribution on frequency and the damping time as well. So ring down analysis actually give an independent measurement of the final mass and the spin of the remnant black hole. Now, measurement of multiple quasi-normal mode frequencies actually enables black hole spectroscopy. And this facilitates a test of Noether theorem. So let's take a look at the brief history of black hole spectroscopy. In 2016, Emanuele Berti with his collaborators, they explored the possibility of doing black hole spectroscopy with the different detectors. So what they search is, they search for detection of more than one quasi-normal mode with using different population model. And what they found is black hole spectroscopy was barely possible with LIGO Voyager-like detector. Later in 2020, another group, they are also from AI Hanover, they did the similar analysis. Some of them are author of our 1905-21 paper as well. So they did the similar analysis, but with more updated population model and more updated waveform model as well. They also found a similar result. So a strong or the substantial evidence of detection of black hole spectroscopy or multimode black hole spectrum is only possible with LIGO Voyager. Yeah, so now let's take a look at black hole spectroscopy with 1905-21 and what we did in this paper. So on the left plot, I have shown the strain, Whiting strain, as a function of time in three different detectors. On the right side plot, I have shown the same strain, but in the frequency domain. Now, what we did first is we tried to search, we did an agnostic search for different modes. For that, we divided the strain in the frequency domain into three bins, A, B, and C. So the A bin runs from frequency 50 to 80 hertz, B is in between 80 to 250 hertz, and C is from 15 to 50 hertz. And as you can see, that most of the power lies in bin A, and then there's some power in B as well. So what we did is we search for single mode frequency in each of these bins. And we also did not assume any relation between these three frequencies, unlike GR. And the result that we found is given in this plot. We found a strong mode in range A and another mode in range B. And we did not find anything in range C. They were mostly consistent with detector noise. Now, if we consider the mode that we found in range A to be the dominant 220 mode as defined in GR, we can compute what could be the frequency and the damping time of the expected 330 mode, which is shown by this purple dashed line. And you can see that it is completely aligned with the bright yellow blob that we find in our agnostic search. So this actually triggered our more rigorous analysis of the bring down part of 1905-21. Now let's take a look at that analysis. So here in this case, we consider that the ring down of 1905-21 to be consistent with the ring down of a curved black hole. Now, of course, we expect that only a subset of the entire spectrum of quasi-normal modes would be visible above noise. And we compare between combinations of various modes, and we use Bayes factor to compare between them and to find the favored model. And the result is shown in this plot, where y-axis denotes the Bayes factor for different combination of modes. So the combination that we tried are, first one is where we consider the dominant 220 along with the subdominant 330 mode. Then also we consider 220 with 221. 221 is the first overtone associated to the dominant 220 mode. And we also consider another combination where we consider most of the other modes, that is 220, 330, 440 with 210. One thing I would like to mention here that there is no hard and fast rule that where exactly we should start our ring down analysis. So for that, we did our analysis at different time, starting from a reference time. And we find this, we use the reference time to be the merger time predicted by one of the updated in spiral merger ring down phenom waveform model. To be specific, we used IMR phenom XPHM to define our TREF. And as you can see, what we find is around 6 or 7 milliseconds after this reference time, we see that for the combination of 220 and 330, the Bayes factor peaks and it has a value of about 40, which indicates a strong evidence of existence of this subdominant 330 mode. So using the data of 1905-21, we found a loud measurable 3-3 ring down quasi-normal mode. Here I have shown the best fit waveform model on the left plot. So we have here we have used the two combinations. The first one only contains the dominant 220 mode, which is denoted by this black curve. And the second combination that we tried is the one 220 plus 330, which is denoted by this orange line. And the corresponding mass and the spin estimates are given on the plot in your right. And as you can see that we find the final mass of the remnant black hole to be roughly of 330 solar mass, whereas the spin is about 0.87. Now we did a test of GR with this particular model. So what we did is until now we were only varying the amplitude, phase, final mass, and final spin of the black hole to get to analyze the data. But to test GR, we also, along with all these parameters, we also let vary the frequency of the 330 mode and the damping time of the same 330 mode. And it's, as you can see from this plot, that the deviation of the frequency and the damping time is completely consistent with their values being zero. We could constrain the frequency of the 330 mode by the deviation to the frequency of 330 mode by 20%. Although the measurement on the damping time is quite poor here, because the power in 330 mode is not that much to make it more precise. And I have also shown the corresponding mass estimates. So the navy blue curve shows the final mass and the final spin posterior when we use the two modes analysis, that is 220 and 330. And if we add the frequency deviation and damping time deviation, the posterior distribution on the masses and the spin enlarges. And which is completely consistent, because we are adding two more parameters to analyze the data. So the error bar increases on mass and the spin. So we can say that the remnant black hole is consistent with general relativity. So to summarize, we have found that JW1905-21 contains a loud measurable 3-3 ring down quasi-normal mode. So there have been a lot of paper about this particular event, 1905-21, so where they consider eccentricity as well. But if 1905-21 was a quasi-circular binary, then the initial black holes had unequal masses, because we have detected the 330 subdomain mode. And we can, of course, say that the remnant object is consistent with the curved black hole. And we constrain deviations from the predicted 3-3 frequency to be within 20%. Last but not the least, I would like to mention here that at the moment, a handful of tests, roughly about 6 or 7 tests, are being performed on every detected gravitational waves. And till date, we have already detected hundreds of gravitational wave events. And these tests have their own validity regime. Now, either we can map them to a particular theory, but of course that is pretty difficult, because they are formulated as a null test of GR. Now, at least if we can find some mapping between different tests, that will either establish the consistency of these tests with each other, and also make any claim of a deviation from GR, of course, if found, stronger. Thank you very much. So I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you, Shilpa. And also thanks for keeping in time. Are there any questions from the audience? Amita, please unmute yourself.
Yeah. Hello, Shilpa.
Hi, Amita.
Yeah. Actually, I wanted to ask, what makes you decide that you want to use the 330 or 220 quasi-normal modes? Is there some physics behind it?
So one thing I can say that we saw this higher mass ratio mode where we can expect that the 330 will be dominant above the other subdominant modes. So basically the higher mass ratio region indicates that it could be 330 mode. But as we have done that, we have used different combination as I showed in this plot. So that actually proves that 330 is the most dominant subdominant mode.
So this information is not coming from looking at the spectrum of quasi-normal modes. So this is coming from some intuition from the data. Is this the correct way of saying it?
No, there is an intuition. So as I said, that if the mass ratio is not equal, or if the system is with unequal mass ratio, then there will be a 330 mode, because 330 mode is associated with the mass difference.
Oh, okay. Thanks.
Yeah.
Any further questions? I don't see any raised hands. If you have any, please unmute yourself and ask.
Hi, I had a small question. So,
yes.
Shilpa, can you comment on the fact that why you have used 2, 2, 3, 3, and 4, 4? I mean, the odd, the even modes. I also see 2, 1 mode. Can you comment on why you haven't included the 3, 2 or 3, 1 modes? Like, they are also like, they also have the significant.
First of all, there have been a lot of studies saying that other modes like 3-2 modes, they have a very little power and they get damped much quickly. So, just to tell you that we have tried other combination of modes as well, but we didn't find anything. So that's why we just showed only these three combinations. In other cases, they were the base factors were quite below one, so we did not show it in our paper.
Now suppose if we include eccentricity to all these modes and how these things change, I mean, does it hold for same modes or do we need to include more subdominant modes as well, like 2, 2, 3, 1 for that case?
If I understand your question correctly, first of all, I don't know how the quasi-normal modes goes if there is eccentricity, since we are, so the quasi-normal modes is basically perturbation of Carr black hole. So these things can be fitted to only after the merger when it's just a perturbed Carr black hole. So I'm not sure how eccentricity goes into these things. But again, so the thing that was done with eccentricity, they were performed with the full waveform and not a, that was not a ring down analysis. So honestly, I don't know.
Any further questions? If not, let's thank Shilpa for a very nice talk.
Thank you. Thank you very much.